Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our lesson for today comes to us from Joel chapter 38, verses 1 to 11. Then the Lord responded to Joel out of a violent storm. He said, "Who is this who spreads darkness over my plans with his ignorant words? Get ready for action like a man. Then I will ask you questions and you will inform me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you understand anything about it. Who determined its dimensions? I am sure you know. Who stretched out the surveying line over it? What supports its foundation? Who set its cornerstone in place? When the morning stars sang loud songs together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, who locked up the sea behind doors when it burst out of the womb? When I clothed the sea with clouds, when I wrapped it with thick darkness as it swaddled in cloaks? When I broke its power with my decree, when I locked it up behind barred double doors, I said, 'You may come this far, but no farther. Here is the barrier for your proud wings.'" This is the word of the Lord. So, the book of Joel is really a fascinating book. It's one that has caused much discussion for many people, much like the discussion that we read throughout the entire book. The whole book seems to deal with one topic, one subject matter, and that is the problem of pain, the problem of suffering, and where does it come from and why receive it. It's really the whole conversation between Joel and, first of all, his three friends, and then a fourth friend who joins the discussion later. But what makes Joel so fascinating is that we, as the readers of this whole lesson, really know the answer to the question, why is Joel suffering? And it's quite maybe confusing, maybe interesting, maybe it makes us wonder how often this might happen, because we hear in the first two chapters that really the reason why Joel, this rich man who had everything going for him, he had great wealth, a wonderful family, why he lost it all is simply because the devil came to God and said, "I bet you he's going to curse you to your face if you take everything away from him." And God says, "Okay, let's see what happens." Just seems so odd. Seems so interesting. Maybe even fascinating. Maybe even terrifying, where we're wondering, how can this be? Does God do this? Is this how we suffer? Is this why we suffer? Does God make bets on us with the devil and allow us to suffer some of the most atrocities that we could possibly think of? Is this why we get sick from time to time? Is this why we suffer? Is this why we lose loved ones? Is it because God and the devil like to gamble? Well, no, that's not what it is, but it does raise a lot of questions. And the whole time, Job doesn't know the answer. Neither do his friends. And we're left watching them discuss Job's suffering. Why is Job, this seemingly righteous man, all of a sudden suffering? And we hear their theories and their answers and their conundrums. But in our section today, we hear God's response. Throughout the whole book, Job is calling on God, "Please answer me. Please explain to me. Defend yourself, God." Job even accuses God of being his enemy at times, and, "You are attacking me for no reason. Explain yourself." And now we get God's final word. And what does God have to say? What does God have to say to us who also wonder, why do I suffer? Why do I have bad days? Why do tragedies strike at the heart of God's people? People whom God loves, why does he allow bad things to happen, not just to me, but to any one of his children? And maybe God's answer might surprise you. Maybe it might even disappoint you. But when we really take a look at the whole of Scripture and we are reminded of who our God is and what He really shows us throughout His Word, we no longer become disappointed with Him. In fact, we realize that we are going to be just fine, and instead rejoice in knowing that our God is there. So let's once again review the beginning of God's answer to Job and hear God's final word on the subject of pain. Like I said, Job was a seemingly wealthy man. He had a large family. He had great wealth. He was high, had a high standing. People came to him for advice. And then all because the devil decided he thought that God was protecting Job a little too much, he challenged God and saying, take away, first of all his possessions and see what Job will do. And then after, when that didn't work, when Job didn't curse God to his face, then the devil said, well, how about you attack his body and give him sores and aches and pains unlike he's ever felt before, and we'll see what happens. And it's after that moment that we start to see the conundrum that Job and his three friends have. And they have this discussion for most of the book. And for the most part, his three friends, or so-called friends, have this theory in mind when they're discussing why Job, a righteous man, is now suffering for no apparent reason. Their reasoning, their belief, their thought is, well, it's cause and effect. If you do bad things, then God's going to do bad things to you. If you are a bad person, God's going to get even with you. That's as simple as that. That's what the friends believe. Job, we don't know what you did. We can't prove it. We can't point it out. All we can say is the reason why you're suffering so bad is because you're a bad person. That's how Job's friends see God. God is a cause and effect God. You do this, he gets even with you. You do that, he fixes it. So all you have to do, Job, is admit you're an evil person, that you sinned, that you did something wrong, and of course, you're going to be healed. And the Lord will take away all this pain and misery. Is that true? Is God a cause and effect God? Is he someone who gets even with his people? Now, in God's word, we know that there are consequences to the actions that we have, but as far as God allowing bad things to happen to us or hurting us, that's not exactly how God describes it. God does discipline his children because he loves us, but only for one purpose, and that purpose is to save us, to keep us focused on him so that we never lose our faith, not to get even with us, not to punish us, not to hurt us. In fact, God hurts alongside of us as we go along. And so Job's friends are being a little cruel, and because they're misguided in how God governs the world. Job's response is, no, I haven't done anything bad. God's just being unfair at this time. Job's really interesting because Job will give us some of the best phrases, the best lines of faith that you'll ever see. When Job lost everything, and they said, curse God and die. And he said, naked I came into this world, naked I will leave. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. May the name of the Lord be praised. What an amazing statement in the face of suffering. Job is also the one who in chapter 19 will also say, in the midst of all his pain, in the midst of his friends calling him a bad person, he will say, I have a redeemer. And I know that he lives. And one day he will stand upon the earth and I will see him with my own eyes. Such great statements of faith that he just trusting and clinging to God as being the only one who can help him. But at the same time struggling with his own suffering, wondering why God is so mean and so cruel and so nasty to him. Because it doesn't appear as if Job deserves it. This brings us to the final friend, who in some ways corrects the three friends by reminding them that, listen, God isn't some mindless being who just has this black and white agenda that if you mess up, then this is going to happen. No, God is smarter than that. He's bigger than that. He has a bigger plan. He knows what he's doing. But he doesn't go all the way. And yet, in the very end, he also comes down to the same conclusion. Job, the reason why you're suffering as bad as you are is because that's how evil you are. Job, you really are an evil person because you're a sinner, and therefore you deserve everything that you get. Well, now we're going to hear God's answer. We're going to hear what God has to say. God actually is going to answer Job's inquiry. Job challenges God, answer me, tell me why I'm suffering. They explain it all to me. And God actually does him the favor of answering him. He's actually going to explain himself, or so it would seem. And this is how God begins. He starts off, "Then the Lord responded to Job out of a violent storm. He said, 'Who is this who spreads darkness over my plans with his ignorant words? Get ready for action like a man. Then I will ask you questions and he will inform me.'" Job's going to get his time with God, but I don't think Job's prepared for what's about to happen, or I don't think the Lord's going to play along the way Job, or maybe even you or I, would want him to play along. Because he starts off right away by saying, "Job, you're ignorant, you don't understand anything. I can't believe you're even talking about this, that you even have the gall to accuse me of anything. Who is this who is darkening my counsel? Who is this who has ignorant words, who knows nothing at all, and yet they're going to speak on this subject?" Sounds as if God's pretty upset with Job right now. Upset with him for even questioning him. Upset with even bringing it up. Even having the nerve to accuse God to his face of wrongdoing, of injustice. Job thinks at first he's the one who's going to question God. God quickly turns the tables. He appears in a storm, which God often does, is appear in storms to emphasize his glory and his power. And now Job is the defendant, and God is going to be the prosecuting attorney. And Job's going to have to explain himself. And how does God defend himself? How does God make his point? Well, he goes right back to the day of creation. He then says, "Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you understand anything about it. Who determined its dimensions? I am sure you know. Who stretched out the surveying line over it? What supports its foundations? Who set its cornerstone in place when the morning stars sang loud songs together and all the sons of God shouted for joy?" God goes back to creation, and he just simply asks the question, "Job, were you there?" Now, of course, Job is going to agree that God created the world. He believes that. He knows that because he believes in God. But was he there? And the answer is no. And that's really the point that God's making. "Job, you weren't there when I started this whole thing. I didn't ask you for your opinion then. What makes you think that your opinion matters today?" And it sounds rather harsh, doesn't it? It sounds pretty mean. It's basically saying, "Job, you just wouldn't understand, so why are you even speaking on the subject? You have no idea what it took to even create this world. How are you going to help me rule this world?" And that's really how God even finishes it. He even explains his power by saying, "Listen, I control the sea. Everyone in this world thinks the sea is a scary place. The big ocean that could come in at any time. Tsunamis could come and wipe out life on the shorelines. And yet I'm the one who said, no, you stay right there. And in fact, the sea is more like a child to God. Where he puts up the blocks and the doors. And he's the one who says, you go this far and no further. He's the one who set the foundations. He's the one who built this whole place. He's the one who created it all. He's the one who set everything in motion. And he did it even though he knew we were going to mess it up. And he still said, let there be light." What makes this second part, this last part of Job so fascinating, is just simply God putting the whole world in its place Any time that the world ever wants to question God's judgment, his rule, or his love, God is simply saying, who are you to even begin to question? Who are you to even begin to understand all that I have ever done, that all that I am, all that I do every single day of your life? You don't even have the least bit of human brain power to even begin to understand this. And what makes it sound so cruel, and maybe what bothers us about it, what makes us maybe frustrated with this answer, is how belittling it feels. God is basically saying, you're too dumb to understand this. You don't get it. You wouldn't know the first thing about it. So who are you to even talk about it, to even question it, to even question the manner in which I provide my love and blessing? And notice that God doesn't even explain what happened. He doesn't say, Job, by the way, the devil thought you would curse me to my face. I knew you wouldn't, but sure, I tested you. I allowed all of this to happen to you because I knew you were going to stay my child. But he doesn't. He doesn't even explain that part of it. And that might frustrate us because we want to know. We feel like we deserve to know. I mean, it's our life. He's kind of messing with it. Why on earth does he not explain himself to us? We want an answer. We want to know why. And we feel like we deserve that much. And when we see God speaking to us as if we're little children who have no idea what's going on, it might frustrate us and anger us and make us just want to yell at God. Or even having the gall to speak to us in such a way. But that's the whole point, isn't it? We really don't have any clue on how to run this world because we have no idea what it took to even create this world. We have no idea what it takes to run a world to make sure that sinners like you and me actually get to heaven. We don't know all the things that we must go through. And to be honest, if you had to choose between having the worst suffering of your life or the easiest life in the world, and you knew that if you had an easy life, that there was a really good chance you weren't going to make it to heaven, do you still think you would say, sure, put me through the worst suffering ever? It'd be really hard. We might want to take our chances and say, well, I'll take the easy life and just see what happens. But we have a God who understands that we need to go through this bad moment. God knows we need to go through this tragedy. God knows we need to be sick at this time, this specific way, for this specific reason. He knows how to run this world so perfectly, and he knows everything, even what could happen or what would happen. And he just sees it all because that's how big and strong and mighty he is. And yeah, we wouldn't understand it. And it's fine. We don't. We don't need to. In fact, we already know that we don't even have to worry about it. We don't even need to question it. We don't even need to worry or be scared or afraid of what our all-powerful, mighty God is going to allow to enter into our lives. Because we already know how he feels about us. Because don't forget, the same God who might allow you to go through the worst pain you have ever felt, it's the same God who took on a much worse pain than we ever will need to feel. He's the one who came down and took on our human flesh and died in our place. He's the one who suffered hell so that we wouldn't have to. He's the reason why all of what we go through in this world is just temporary, and our eternal life is so beautiful and glorious that it's not even worth comparing to the life we have today. We so often want to know the why, and we actually already know the answer. It's because God loves you. He loves you so much that he's willing to do whatever it takes to get you to heaven. He loves you so much that he's willing to make the tough decisions for you in your life so that you will keep your focus on him, so that you will be with him forever in heaven. He loves you so much that he is willing even to die and suffer hell in your place, so that you don't even have to feel the wrath that we all deserve. The thing with Job's friends is that while they're wrong about how God runs the world, that's how God should run the world because of our sinfulness. It should be, you do this, I get even with you. But imagine what our lives would be like if that's how God ruled. If God said, you sin, I'm going to get even with you, how horrible would our lives be? For how often do we sin every day? That's not how our God rules. He rules with love unlike any other. He gives us so many blessings we can't even begin to count. We have more good days than bad days. And the fact that God will at times allow a bad day to enter into our life so that we can have an eternity of good days is completely worth it. And knowing that it is our God who created the earth, who controls the sea, that nothing is bigger and stronger than him, and who also loves us with a love that we could never even begin to fathom, is the one calling the shots. Well, I don't know about you, but I can sleep fine with that. I can sleep great at night knowing that, yes, even if tomorrow is the worst day of my life, I still know who's in charge. I know who's governing it. I know who's watching over me. And if God and the devil are going to bet on me, well, I'm happy God's on my side to make sure it all turns out well. God's final word when it comes to our suffering and pain is don't worry about it. I got you. I always will. I always have. I've known you since the beginning of time. I knew you before you were even formed. I knew you before I even said, let there be light. I knew that you would be born. I knew what your life would be like. I knew what you would go through. And yet I still tell you, do not be afraid. Do not worry about your life. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow has enough worries of its own. Just face the day, and knowing that you're facing it with the Lord, and know that whatever happens, whatever decisions he makes, it's for your good and for your benefit so that you will be in heaven with him one day. And knowing that heaven's going to be so much greater than this world could ever be, what really do we need to worry about? What do we even need to be afraid of? And the answer is nothing, because of who our God is and what he will continuously do for us every day of our lives. Amen. Please rise.